If you're trying to solve a problem, let me be specific. You gotta use the method that's scientific.
Hi, I'm Baya Enoch, a tutor from North Coast Medical Training College, a clinical officer by profession. Today I'm going to take you through the introduction to cardiovascular system, that is the structure and the function of the cardiovascular system, or we can simply say the anatomy and physiology of the cardiovascular system. So first things first, when you hear about the cardiovascular system, what do you think of? What do you think the cardiovascular system is? The cardiovascular system is a system in the body that is enclosed, or it's more of a closed system that deals with transportation of blood. The blood is the major transport system in the body, so the cardiovascular system helps in transporting the blood throughout the body. Now, when you talk of the cardiovascular system, it has different components. It has three main components. We have the heart, we have the vessels, and then we have the blood. So for today's lesson, we are going to look at two components, that is the heart and the blood vessels. Let's look at the first component, that is the heart. And when we talk about the heart, we are going to look at where the heart is located. We are going to look at the size of the heart. We are going to look at the structure of the heart. So, where is your heart located? The heart, my heart is located in a space in the thoracic cavity that we call the mediastinum. And this space is found in between the two lungs. We have the left lung and the right lung. Now, in between these two lungs, there is a space that we are calling the mediastinum. And it is in this space, the mediastinum, that the heart is located. Now, the heart is surrounded by other organs. So inferior to the heart, or below the heart, we have the diaphragm. Superior to the heart, or above the heart, we have the major blood vessels. Anterior to the heart, or in front of the heart, we have the bone sterna. And then posterior to the heart, or behind the heart, lies the esophagus, the descending aorta, and we have the bony vertebral column. What's the size of your heart? The size of your heart is approximately the size of your fist. Now, the heart is a muscular organ, and it beats, or it contracts and relaxes ceaselessly, continuously, because the act of pumping blood is something that is a continuous process. It never stops. That's why we are saying the heart beats continuously. Now, the heart is a muscular organ, and it beats, or it contracts and relaxes ceaselessly, continuously, because the act of pumping blood is something that is a continuous process. It never stops. That's why we are saying the heart beats continuously. Now that we are saying the heart pumps blood, this means the heart acts as a pump. Now, let's take our minds off the heart a bit and look at the different pumps that we know. We have pumps, for those who love sports, we have pumps that we can use to inflate balls, different types of balls like the basketball, the football, the volleyball. We have pumps, a good example is the pump I'm holding here. We can use this pump to inflate a football or any type of ball. And the same way that this pump works is the same way that the heart works. Then it means they have similar structures, or they are similar in the structures. So we are going to look at this pump, look at the structures it has, and then compare it to the pump that is pumping blood now and not air, as the one I'm holding, that is the heart, and see the structures that it has. So one, this makes the body of the pump, and we can call this the chamber of the pump. We have a tube, we have a rubber in here that acts as a valve, a one-way valve. It allows air only to go out of this tube, but it doesn't allow air to go in through this tube. We have this handle that when we want to use the pump, we hold and pull. Then by pushing it down, it forces air out through the tube. Similarly, our heart has these structures. Our heart has four chambers, two ventricles and two atria, the right and left ventricle and the right and left atrium. The heart has valves, just like the valve in this mechanical pump that I just showed allow air only out of the tube and not into the tube. The valves also control the direction that the blood flows towards. Then we have blood vessels. Just like the pump has this tube that allows air out of the pump, our heart has blood vessels that take blood into the heart and out of the heart. So I think that comparison brings us to a conclusion that the mechanical pump or the heart works the same way as the mechanical pump, and if you compare the structures of this heart, then they are alike or they are almost similar to the structures of this mechanical pump. The heart is an organ or a muscular organ. So let's briefly look at the layers that make this heart, because the heart is a multi-layered organ. It's not made up of only one layer, it's made up of different layers. So let's look at these layers that make this heart. On the outermost, or the outermost layer of the heart, is a membrane that you're calling a pericardium. Peri, from the word perimeter, meaning around. Then cardium, from the word cardio, which we said the cardio means the heart. So there's a thin membrane that covers this heart, and that is what we are calling a pericardium. Then just below the pericardium, we have the muscular layer of the heart now, and we are calling it the myocardium. Myo simply means muscle. Then cardium still comes from the word cardio, which means the heart. So the muscle of the heart. And this middle layer is the one that makes or forms the bulk of the heart. It forms a big chunk of the heart. And then finally, from the inside, we have the endocardium. Endo simply meaning inside. So it's the inner layer or the inner lining of the heart. Endo, inside, cardium, heart. So the endocardium. Let's now take a look at the chambers of the heart. We said there are four, two atria and two ventricles. So the atria are found on the upper part of the heart, and the ventricles are found on the bottom part of the heart. The left and the right atria are separated by a septum, and because it is between the atria, we can call it an interatrial septum. The same thing happens to the ventricles. They are separated from one another by a septum, and because it is between or in between the ventricles, we can call it an interventricular septum. So let's look at what the atria do. The atria are found on the upper part of the heart, and their work is to receive blood. We know that blood enters the heart during two different times. We have blood coming into the heart from the systems or from the systemic circulation, that is the other part of the body. And then we have blood coming into the heart from the lungs. So blood coming from the systemic circulation or from the other parts of the body will come into the heart through the right atrium, and then blood coming from the lungs will come into the heart through the left atrium. The opposite is true, that is the work of the ventricles. The ventricles play a role of ejecting or forcing blood out of this heart. So the right ventricle will push blood out of the heart into the lungs for oxygenation, while the left ventricle will push blood out of the heart to the other parts of the body so that these parts receive blood that is oxygenated. We say that the heart also has valves, which help in maintaining the flow or one directional flow of blood. Now, which valves are these? In between the atria and the ventricles, we have valves. And these valves help blood not to go back to the atria once the ventricles contract, because the atria contract at the same time, and once the atria contract, then the ventricles relax so that they can receive the blood that is pushed from the atria. When the ventricles contract, we don't want the blood from these ventricles to go back to the atria. We want the blood from these ventricles to go into the blood vessels that are leading to the parts where this blood is supposed to go to. So these valves that are found between the atria and the ventricles prevent this backflow of blood into the atria. And because they are found in between an atria and a ventricle, we can call them atrioventricular valves. We still have valves at the base of the aorta and the base of the pulmonary trunk, because the right or the left ventricle will pump blood out of the heart into the systemic circulation through the aorta. So once the contraction happens, the blood goes into the aorta, but once this ventricle relaxes, we don't want blood to flow back into this left ventricle. So we have a valve at the base of the aorta that will only open once the contraction happens, so that blood goes out. And then once a relaxation of the ventricle happens, the flaps come back together. And when the flaps come back together, then it means blood cannot flow back into this ventricle. The same happens at the pulmonary trunk, at the base of the pulmonary trunk. We have valves which also are going to act the same way that the aortic valves work. Then we have the cardiac cycle. What is a cardiac cycle? A cardiac cycle is represented by a single beat of the heart. Once blood enters the heart and leaves, then that is a cardiac cycle. The coming in of blood into the heart and the ejection of this blood out of the heart is what we can simply call the cardiac cycle. Then we can divide the circulation into two types of circulation, because we said this whole system is called the circulation, the circulatory system. But then we can divide this circulation into two. We can have the pulmonary circulation and the systemic circulation. When we are talking about the pulmonary circulation, we are talking of the blood going to the lungs and coming back to the heart. Pulmonary here means the lungs, or represents the lungs. So the pumping of blood from the heart to the lungs and back to the heart is what you're calling the pulmonary circulation. And then the systemic circulation here simply means the pumping of blood from the heart to the other parts of the body, that is all the other systems, and then coming back to the heart. That is the systemic circulation. Now, we said once you want to pull or to use the mechanical pump, you hold the handle and pull it. By pulling it, you are exerting or you're using some energy, because the pump can't work on its own. It has to have a source of energy. The same way, our heart needs a source of energy, or it needs something that enables it or it signals it to beat. We say that the pump beats ceaselessly. So it means it needs a system that will help it maintain this beating or the rhythm that it's beating with. And this takes us to the conducting or the conduction system of the heart. In the right atria, we have specialized cells just below the vena cava. We have a node of specialized cells. We are calling it the SA node, in full the sinoatrial node. This node is the one that acts as a pace setter of the heart. So it generates the impulses, and once the impulses are generated, these impulses are the ones that signal the heart to contract and relax, contract and relax. So the SA node, as we said, is found in the right atria. And once the impulse is generated on this SA node, then it has to be passed to the other parts of the heart. We said the middle layer of the heart is the myocardium. And this myocardium is the one that can contract and relax. So once this signal is generated at the SA node, then it has to be passed to the other parts so that the heart can contract. Now, what happens, or how are these signals passed? We say that the atrium or the atria are separated by a septum. So the septum separating the atria allows this signal to pass. So the signal is generated in the right atrium, but then because the septum allows the passage of these signals, it passes directly into the left atrium. And once it passes there, then it means that part or the atria can contract. Then, just above the valves that separate the right atria and the right ventricle, we have another node that you're calling the AV node. And in full, it's the atrioventricular node. This node picks the signals that are generated at the SA node and passes these signals to the ventricles. We have a fiber that is connected to this node, and then the fiber divides into several branches which innervate or which enter into the muscles of the ventricles, and these branches are called the Purkinje fibers. So once the signals are collected by the AV node, they are passed down to the Purkinje fibers, and then once they are passed to the Purkinje fibers, they reach the muscles, and then the muscles of the ventricles contract. Now, we don't want the atria and the ventricles to contract at the same time, because once the ventricles or once the atria contract, it means blood from the atria passes into the ventricles. And then when the ventricles contract, blood from the ventricles is passed either to the lungs or to the other systems. So the contraction of these two parts of the heart should work interchangeably. Like they should come one at a time. If the atria contracts, then it means the ventricles have to relax so that they receive the blood. And when the ventricles contract, it means the atria relax and receive blood either from the other parts of the body or from the lungs. What enables this? Because we have the signals generated and passed to the AV node, and then contraction happens. So what enables this timely contraction of the atria and contraction of these ventricles? We have a fibrous skeleton separating the atria from the right atrium from the right ventricle. Now, this fibrous membrane or the fibrous skeleton that lies there, that separates these two atria, makes it possible for the delay, because it delays the picking of this signal by the AV node by a minimum or a certain duration. And this delay of picking of these signals then means the atria cannot contract at the same time as the ventricles. We can trace or we can look at the functioning or the electrical conductivity of the heart by doing a certain test that we are calling the ECG or the electrocardiogram. This is a test that generates a certain graph that has different waves. We have the PQRST waves, and once you look at how these waves are, then you can tell whether the conducting system of the heart is working well or not. We talked of the cardiac cycle. Now, there are pressures and volumes and volume changes in the cardiac cycle. And one of the volume that we have is the cardiac output. What is cardiac output? Cardiac output is the amount of blood ejected by each ventricle per minute. So once the ventricle contracts, it forces blood out of the heart. So that amount of blood that the ventricle is going to force out in a minute, in a duration of 1 minute, is what we are calling the cardiac output. Then we have a stroke volume, and the stroke volume is the amount of blood ejected by the ventricle in one contraction. A ventricle contracts. Now this amount that is going to be forced out of this ventricle in that one contraction is what we are calling the stroke volume. Then the amount of blood that is going to be forced out of that ventricle in a duration of 1 minute or in a span of 1 minute is what we are calling the cardiac output. What does this mean? The stroke volume multiplied by the number of times that this ventricle is going to contract in a minute is what is going to give us the cardiac output. And the number of times that the heart is going to contract in a minute is what you're calling the heart rate. So in simple terms, you're saying cardiac output then will be equal to the stroke volume multiplied by the heart rate. And there are three factors that are going to influence the volumes. And they are the ones that are responsible for changes in the cardiac output. These factors are preload, contractility of the heart, and the afterload. When you're talking of the preload, we are talking of the degree of stretch of the heart muscles just before it contracts. The higher the degree of stretch, the more the blood this ventricle or the chamber is going to accommodate. If it accommodates more, then it means it is going to push a lot of blood out of it. So that leads to an increased cardiac output. Contractility of the heart muscle. The more the heart can contract, the more blood it can push out. The lesser it contracts, the lesser the amount of blood is going to push out. And then we have the last factor, that is the afterload. And this is the back pressure exerted by blood on major arteries leaving the heart. This is the pressure that the contracting ventricles must overcome in order to eject the blood. If we have a lot of pressures, or if we have a lot of resistance in the vessels leaving the heart, then it means this ventricle has to contract forcefully, or it has to use more force to contract. And if it doesn't have that force to contract, if it doesn't contract hard enough to overcome the pressure exerted by these vessels, then it means it will push out a little amount of blood. And if it pushes out a little amount of blood, then this changes the cardiac output. The lesser the amount is ejected, the lower the cardiac output. The more the amount ejected, the higher the cardiac output. How is the heartbeat regulated, or how is the heart rate regulated? We have the normal heart rate being 60 to 100 beats per minute. And if someone comes to your facility, or if someone comes to you and you check the heartbeat or the pulse rate, because we check the heartbeat by checking the pulse rate, you check the pulse rate and you find that it's below 60 beats per minute, then we say this person has bradycardia. We term it as bradycardia. It's below the normal. Brady meaning low, and cardia for the heart. So bradycardia, low heart rate. And then if it's above 100, we are saying this person has tachycardia, meaning they have a higher pulse rate. So how is the regulation of the heart rate achieved? We have the autonomic nervous system. I believe we've gone through the nervous system, so we understand what we mean by autonomic nervous system. The autonomic nervous system regulates the heart through the sympathetic branch, its sympathetic branch, and specifically, it's the vagus nerve that increases the heart rate through initiation of release of adrenaline, which is a hormone. Then we still have other chemicals that can also help in regulation of the heart rate. We have other hormones. An example is the norepinephrine. The more this hormone is produced, the higher the heart rate will be. We have ions, e.g. the calcium and potassium ions. These ions play a role in muscle contractions. So if we have a lot of them, then it means the heart is going to contract more. So the heartbeat or the heart rate is going to be high. We also have other factors that influence the heart rate. A good example is the age. A child's heart beats faster, or the heart rate is higher as compared to the heart rate of an adult. Gender, exercise, body temperature. I believe if you're walking or if you're seated, your heart rate will be lower compared to someone who is running or who is exercising. This is because of the amount of oxygen needed and all that. Let's not go into that for now. But exercise, someone who is exercising will have a higher pulse rate as compared to someone who is seated or who is relaxed. Now, let's go to the second component of the cardiovascular system, that is the blood vessels. We said the blood vessels are the channels through which blood travels throughout the body. And they're divided into arteries, capillaries, and veins. From the knowledge that we have, maybe from our primary school or our high school or secondary school, we know that the structures or these arteries or these blood vessels have a bit of differences in their structures. So let's look at the general structure of a blood vessel, and then we are going to look at a bit of the differences of the types of vessels in structure, and then we'll call it a day. So a blood vessel has three layers, just like the heart, and we call these layers the tunics. Now from outside inside, we have the tunic or tunica externa. Externa from the word external, so that is the outermost layer. Then just below it, we have the tunica media. Media from medium, meaning middle. And then we have tunica intima. Intima from internal. So we have the innermost layer. So we have three layers: tunica externa, tunica media, and tunica intima. I believe we know the difference in functions of these vessels, the blood vessels. We have arteries carrying blood away from the heart at high pressures. We have veins returning blood to the heart at low pressures. That is the difference in functions. All the arteries carry oxygenated blood, with an exception of one artery, and it's the pulmonary artery that carries blood from the heart to the lungs. And then all veins carry the oxygenated blood, with an exception of the pulmonary veins that carry oxygenated blood from the lungs back to the heart before it's supplied to the other parts of the body. Structurally, we have some few differences. Arteries are thick, they are strong, and the reason as to why they are thick is because blood inside arteries flow under higher pressures. So the thickness is an adaptation so that these arteries don't burst. The opposite is the same for veins. They have a very thin wall, or they're very thin, and blood inside them flows under a very low pressure. So they don't have to be thin because they are not at any risk of bursting. The lumen of arteries is narrow, while the lumen of veins is wider. Arteries don't have valves in them, because the blood in them flows at a very high pressure, so it's not able to flow backwards. As compared to the veins, the blood in veins moves at a very low pressure, so we have to have mechanisms that are put in place to control the flow of this blood. We don't want blood to start going to the wrong direction, so we have one-way valves that ensure that blood flows only towards one direction. Let's look at the blood pressure briefly. And I'm sure you've heard people say, I've gone to the hospital and I've been told I have blood pressure. I've been told I have pressure. Yeah? Now what they mean to say is they have a higher blood pressure. Not that they have blood pressure, but they have a high blood pressure. You either have a normal blood pressure, a low blood pressure, or a high blood pressure. Everybody has a blood pressure. What differs is whether it's normal, high, or low. Now, what is blood pressure? Blood pressure is the force exerted on the wall of the blood vessels by the blood it contains. Once the blood is passing through the vessels, there's a certain pressure that it exerts on the walls of the vessels it's passing through, and this is what you're calling blood pressure. And it is determined by two key factors: one, the cardiac output, and two, the peripheral resistance. We already talked about the cardiac output, the amount of blood that is ejected from the heart in a span of 1 minute. Now, peripheral resistance is the force that opposes the flow of blood within the vessels. So we have blood that wants to pass through the vessel or a certain vessel, but then there's a certain pressure that is opposing this blood, that is preventing this blood from flowing smoothly. Now, if peripheral resistance is high, then the pressure will be high. If the cardiac output increases, this also means our blood pressure increases. We measure blood pressure in millimeters of mercury height, and in normal health, it is relatively constant. When recording also, we record it as a fraction. So the numerator represents the systolic blood pressure, and the denominator here is going to represent the diastolic blood pressure. Now, what do I mean by systolic blood pressure? What do I mean by diastolic pressure? Systolic pressure is recorded or can be obtained when the heart contracts. And then when the heart relaxes, the pressure it exerts, or the pressure this blood exerts during that time in the vessels, is what you're calling the diastolic pressure. And the difference between these two pressures is called the pulse pressure. That brings us to the end of our lecture today. I believe you've enjoyed it and you've learned something. In case of any questions, you can always reach out. See you next time.
Ask a question based on observations. Observe, ask, look around, accept no imitations.
2.
Make a prediction, an idea that you can test. That's your hypothesis. It's a kind of careful guess.
3.